Hi! Time to test a new show laser that might set a new record on my laser power meter. I will attempt to measure the track spacing on a mighty laser disc with it. A track spacing that for some reason is poorly documented online. I will also open up the laser to see if there are any improvements in the optical system compared to the first version of the LaserCube Ultra. Let's find out! When experimenting with a laser, wear safety glasses suitable for its wavelength and power output. 2.5 years ago, I tested the original version of the LaserCube Ultra. Now, Wicked Lasers have released a Mark II version of it. Seen from the front, they are very similar. The logo has changed into a show laser drawable version. Nice touch. The new version is slightly taller due to a 50% thicker base plate, making the housing more cubic. The lasers are also very similar according to the labels. Hardly any upgrades, until you look at the backs. They went full professional with the connectivity on the Mark II. This one can easily be integrated into most lighting systems. Well, you don't even need to connect it to anything to project a laser show. The newly added LCD screen makes this an easy-to-use standalone system if needed. In my previous video, I demonstrated the poor safety of most laser pointers, except the LaserGlow Hercules. I am therefore happy about the new version of Interlock system on the Mark II, taking safety to a new level. You have the option to make two keys necessary. And yes, they are both trapped key interlocks like on the Hercules. This all adds a tactile feeling, lost in a modern world with touchscreens and wireless connections. It physically reminds you of the extreme power hiding in this little cube. It is advertised as 7.5 watts, 7,500 optical milliwatts. If that doesn't sound like much to you, watch an earlier video where I engrave on rock with a laser of less power. But is it really that much? Time for a laser power meter test. Thanks to a tip from one of my patrons, I can now run the laser with a static beam for as long as I want. But 10 seconds should be enough for the LPM with this strong a laser. I wonder if the laser is stronger with the 120 watts power supply connected than on battery alone. I mean, my portable speaker has more power with its charger connected. Let's try on the almost fully charged battery first. Oh yeah! 7.98 watts at the aperture, after losses in the optics. New record on my LPM. Now with the charger attached and 4 more runs for good measure. Okay, the laser doesn't care if the charger is attached or not. It does drop a little as the diodes heat up, but that's just the nature of laser diodes. They are more efficient when cold. Looking at this, I really want to see a full 8 watts on the LPM. Let me try a longer run. Here we go. Come on! Ah, you've got to be kidding me. Fine, I will still call this an 8 watt peak laser, just need a slightly colder room. Amazing output from a battery powered show laser. Now, you may wonder how a projection from such a strong laser could ever be safe to watch. I would usually never watch the reflection of a dot from a Class 4 laser without laser safety glasses. Well, under normal use, the dot from a show laser is never static. It is constantly on the move over a large area, spreading the power and, in turn, the energy. I tried filming this small projection at 1000 frames per second, but even in just a millisecond, the dot covers quite a distance. It moves seriously fast. Still, never ever let the beam or spectral reflections of it hit any eyes directly. How about the laser's colors, also known as the wavelengths? I am doing this carefully with the laser at the lowest possible power setting. The strongest laser diode, the blue laser, is barely turned on. Okay, they are all a little below nominal. A clear indication of the laser diodes running cool at the low power setting. Great! With this information, I can now attempt to measure the track spacing of this ancient optical storage format, a laser disc, with the show laser. I can't find any reliable specifications on the track spacing online, perhaps because this format predates the World Wide Web by more than a decade. Honestly, laser discs are not great diffraction gratings, and a high-powered multi-beam show laser with a 4mm wide beam isn't the best choice for this either. But I will use the method from an earlier video where I determined the track spacing at 0.1 microns precision on a CD with a laser pointer. Really worth a watch or rewatch. With the laser at its minimum power setting for lowest risk, I carefully found a usable spot on the laser disc and measured the distances needed for the calculations. The setup was not perfectly aligned. Note how the first order diffractions are not centered around the zeroth order as they should be. The laser beam was not perpendicular to the wall, but at less than 4% off, it should be fine for an estimation. The measurements fit with a track spacing of 1.786 micrometers for this CLV NTSC laser disc. 1.8 microns. Seems reasonable considering the later invented CD format uses a tighter, harder to read track spacing around 1.6 microns. 1.8 microns still equals an impressive 555 lines per millimeter. Alright, after a short message, we will take a look inside the new Ultra Mark II. Did they modify the optical system? A huge thank you to all my patrons. Thank you so much for helping out. It's really appreciated and important for a niche channel with monthly quality uploads like mine. For just a dollar a month, you can help me out too and get full access to all my posts on patreon.com. Link to my Patreon page in the description. Thank you. Opening the Mark II is exactly like opening the Mark I, so watch my video on that one for detailed instructions. Not that I recommend opening the show laser for anything else than a future battery change. Dust and fingerprints can cause damage inside an 8000 milliwatts laser, not to mention the strong stray light if powered up open. Okay, we're in. Same size of battery pack, just mounted more solidly with two brackets instead of one. And the BMS board has moved up next to the battery to make room for all that backplate electronics. The fascinating optics are the same as in the Mark I and explained in details in the earlier video. I do spot a few upgrades and modifications though. One of the challenges of cramming this much laser power into this small a space is stray light. Simply because the lasers and optics are inevitable close to the aperture window. I see some new metal plates blocking the stray light from coming out of the aperture. The blocking blob and plate near the blue laser are not new, but this near one of the red lasers is. The glass plate in front of the red lasers is gone. Maybe they switched to closed can red laser diodes that have their own protection against moisture and dust, like the green and blue diodes. In any case, the laser still works after I open it and unplug the battery for a while. I don't really have the large space or a global shutter camera to do this powerful show laser any justice. But I do like the visual effect of this accessory, a hologram net. If you can find the right and safe space for it, the floating in mid-air effect is beautiful. Hope you enjoyed this video enough to click like and perhaps subscribe for more like it. In any case, thanks for watching. Bye for now.